Good afternoon and welcome to White House History Live. I'm Stuart McLaurin, president of the White House Historical Association, and my colleagues and I are working from our homes, as all of you are, and we wanted to bring a bit of our content to you this afternoon that we would ordinarily share with the gathering at our headquarters, Historic Decatur House, on Lafayette Square, just across the street from the White House. But today, we have the opportunity of sharing with a much broader audience, and we hope that you enjoy this content and come to us as a firsthand source for great, rich, wonderful resources related to the White House and its history. These are very difficult times for our nation, and it's very important to our staff that everyone stays safe and healthy, and it's our concern for you that you stay safe and healthy as well. But this is a wonderful way to entertain your family and learn something and grow together as a result of these wonderful educational resources. Those of you who do follow us on Facebook and know us know of our historic mission, that we're a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization, that we provide non-taxpayer funding every year to maintain the beautiful museum standard for the staterooms of the White House that Mrs. Kennedy envisioned when she founded our organization in 1961. But also important to her at that time and important to us still to this day is our education mission, to teach, to tell these wonderful, insightful stories of the White House and its history going back to 1792. They're great and grand stories, and they're challenging, difficult, and hard stories like we will hear about today. Today is Giving Tuesday in our country, and there are many causes that are worthy to give to and many that I know that you support, but there is only one White House, and the White House is known as the People's House. Mrs. Kennedy has a wonderful quote saying, "The White House belongs to the American people, and that's you." So investing in our work, and you can do so on our website, whitehousehistory.org. By investing in our work, you can enable events and programs like this to happen. You can support our researchers and our scholars, all of our programs for teachers and students. It's amazing how central the White House is to American history. And so much of our history as a country is connected through that one building, those who lived and worked in the White House. Today, you're going to hear wonderful insights on slavery at the White House and five untold stories. I'm going to hand the program over now to two of my really terrific colleagues, Dr. Colleen Shogan, who is Senior Vice President and leads the David M. Rubenstein National Center for White House History, and one of our really wonderful White House historians, Lina Mann. The program is all yours, Colleen and Lina. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Stuart. Welcome to White House History Live, and good afternoon and good evening, wherever you're joining us from. We have a terrific program for you this evening. I'm joined here by my colleague, Lina Mann. Let me tell you a little bit about Lina before we get started with our program. Lina is a White House historian at the White House Historical Association. She received her bachelor's degree in history from St. Mary's College in Maryland and her master's degree in public history from American University. She's worked at numerous historical societies and cultural institutions before coming to work with us at the White House Historical Association, including the Maryland Historical Society, the Baltimore County Historical Society, and the National Park Service. Since she's been working with us at the White House Historical Association, she has been focused on researching the lives of enslaved individuals who both worked in the White House and worked to build the White House. So welcome to White House History Live, Lina.
Thank you for having me, Colleen.
So a little bit about the program before we get started. Lina will be taking questions at the end of the program. So if you have questions for her, please type those comments in Facebook and we will get to as many questions as possible at the conclusion of the program. So to kick it off, Lina, can you tell us a little bit about the Slavery in the President's Neighborhood Research Initiative that was launched in February 2020 by the White House Historical Association? If some of our viewers go to whitehousehistory.org and click on the Slavery in the President's Neighborhood Initiative, what will they find?
Yeah, so the White House Historical Association officially launched our new initiative in February of 2020. And this initiative tells the stories of the enslaved and free African Americans who built, lived, and worked at the White House, as well as the surrounding homes on Lafayette Park. So while there are so many written, there are often few written accounts of enslaved people's experiences, their voices can be found in the letters, the newspapers, memoirs, census records, architecture, and oral histories. So by connecting these details, the association has sought to return these individuals to the historical forefront by intertwining their stories with the lives of presidents, first ladies, and first families. So to start out this research, the association took a closer look at the presidents that relied on enslaved labor at the White House. According to existing records, 9 U.S. presidents relied on this labor, while 12 total presidents owned enslaved people at some point throughout their life. So in addition to talking about slavery at the White House, we also expanded our research to look at slavery in the surrounding president's neighborhood. Many people think of the White House as a democracy, but it is also important to remember its complicated past and the paradoxical relationship between slavery and freedom that exists in the broader nation's capital and the United States. So in order to share our research with the public, the White House Historical Association has launched an accompanying website, and this is what the homepage will look like when you click on it. As you get into the site, there are various things you can do. You can check out an index of enslaved individuals. You can look at our frequently asked questions, additional resources, and also a virtual tour of Decatur House, which is the only site, the only urban site of a slave quarters within sight of the White House. So in addition to all of these resources, the main feature of this initiative is the interactive timeline. This portion of the website features a number of articles about enslaved individuals in a timeline scrollable format. So you can click out to articles, or you can also click on pop-outs and learn more information about events in American history and the history of slavery. So today I'm going to highlight 5 of these stories that we have featured in this initiative and share them with all of you.
Great. Well, let's get started. In 2016, First Lady Michelle Obama stated, "I wake up every morning in a house that was built by slaves." Tell us about what you've learned about the lives of the enslaved individuals who actually built the White House.
So in my research on the construction of the White House, I found that enslaved people were involved in every aspect of White House construction. And this extended from the quarrying of stone to the cutting of timber to the physical construction of its roof and walls. They worked alongside white contract laborers and skilled craftsmen who were usually of European descent. So once President George Washington selected the site for the White House, he also selected 3 commissioners to oversee this construction. Each of these men came from the local landed elite and owned enslaved people. So when discussing construction, it is important to remember them and also note that the Capitol building was built at the exact same time as the White House. And it is also evident that these commissioners quickly adopted a system of short-term hire for enslaved individuals to build these public buildings. So the subject of slavery does first appear in the commissioner's records on April 13, 1792. So when the commissioners moved to advertise the following, the commissioners resolved to hire good laboring Negroes by the year, the masters clothing them well and finding each a blanket, the commissioners finding them provisions and paying £21 a year. So throughout the building of the White House, these resolutions do appear frequently. Essentially, instead of purchasing enslaved individuals for the government, they used a system of contract hire. So they would hire enslaved and free workers either by the month, quarterly, or by the year. During this time, owners collected a wage while continuing to provide housing, some clothing, and also some medical care. And this allowed the new city to reap benefits of labor without bearing a total responsibility for the workers' general well-being. So if an enslaved worker didn't show up, the overseer would simply dock the pay given to an owner. Using the list of the enslaved people and their owners, which are compiled from payrolls, I was able to conduct a mapping search through genealogical research to determine more about the individuals that worked on the White House. Where were they coming from, et cetera. And since Washington, D.C. was barely a city yet in the 1790s, it was clear that the commissioners were pulling labor from other parts of Maryland and Virginia. And my mapping has demonstrated this to be the case. So in particular, a majority of workers do seem to have come from Southern Maryland, which is a place with tons of tobacco plantations and also easy access to the Potomac River, which flows right up to Washington. And I want to highlight the story today of the Brent sisters, Eleanor, Elizabeth, Mary, Jane, and Teresa. These women each appear in records related to the commissioner's proceedings. So a receipt that I found was dated July 7th, 1796 from a cobbler named Delphi, actually lists each of these sisters and also shoes that were made for their enslaved people. So according to a receipt, Eleanor fitted Charles and David, Elizabeth fitted Gabe and Henry, Jane fitted Sylvester, and Teresa fitted Nace for new shoes. And this receipt ends up providing an example of the terms of short-term contract hire for the enslaved. While the commissioners did provide payment to the slave owners, the owners themselves were often responsible for providing other things like clothing. It also is a great example of slave ownership for women. It is not talked about as much, and it is harder to find in the records, but it is important to recognize that some women actively owned enslaved people and did cash in on the building boom in early Washington, D.C.
The first president, Lina, that actually used enslaved labor inside the White House was Thomas Jefferson. And we know from records that Thomas Jefferson brought several teenage girls with him to the White House from Monticello. One of those teenage girls was named Frances Hearne. Can you tell us about Frances, what her life was like, and what her work was like at the White House?
Sure. So Frances, or Fanny, as she was commonly known, first arrived at the White House in 1806, and she was just 18 years old. And she was the final teenage girl from Monticello to go to the White House. Previously, two other young women had been brought, and one of them had returned to Monticello, so she replaced her. She joined another woman named Edith in the kitchens, and they trained with Jefferson's French chef, Julian. And life for Fanny in the Jefferson White House must have been tremendously difficult. For one, Fanny was separated from her family and friends at Monticello. And also to ensure her loyalty and to prevent her running away, it seems that Jefferson made an effort to select Fanny specifically because she had strong family ties to Monticello. She had many family members there, and also her husband, Davy Hearne, worked as a wagon driver, nail maker, and blacksmith at Monticello. So as an apprentice chef, she worked in the White House kitchens, and she learned the art of French cooking, and she also became skilled at managing the open, temperamental hearth that they had, which required lots of careful attention to detail in order to cook dishes properly. But the many guests at Jefferson's dinners often praised the delicious food coming from the White House kitchens. So we know that she and her counterparts were very skilled. And when she was not cooking for Jefferson, Hearne dealt with many other concerns regarding her personal life. It is highly likely that Fanny made friends within Washington's thriving free Black community. And Jefferson did pay her $2 a month as a gratuity. It's important to note that this was not a wage, but this small amount did allow Fanny to participate in Washington life to a certain extent, which probably helped to expand her worldview. Fanny also gave birth at the White House in 1808. Sadly, her child did die from whooping cough in November of that year, and the child's passing was recorded in an account book stating that a Peter Lennox had built the baby's coffin. So while Fanny was preparing to bury her child, Jefferson sent a letter to his Monticello overseer asking him to inform Fanny's husband of the death of the child. And a few days later, the overseer responded that Davy has petitioned for leave to come to see his wife at Christmas. He being so good a fellow, I hate to deny him. So it seems that Jefferson did take pity on Davy and allowed him to travel to the White House so that he could be with Fanny for a 10-day leave period. And they did mourn the loss of that child together. We also know that the relationship that Fanny had with her husband, Davy, was surely tested due to the time that they spent apart. They were only able to see each other about twice a year when Davy brought carts of supplies from Monticello to the White House. So they definitely didn't get to see each other very often, but on one visit, they got into a really terrible quarrel. And the fighting was so intense that Jefferson immediately summoned his Monticello overseer to come to the White House. And when he arrived, he told them to sell the couple immediately in Alexandria, Virginia, which is a slavery hotspot. So when the Hearns kind of realized the severe consequences to their actions, they approached Jefferson and wept, begged, and made such an ado that they begged the old gentleman out of it. Luckily for Fanny, she was able to return to Monticello following Jefferson's presidency, and she continued to assist in the kitchens. Later, she was sold at the Monticello estate sale in 1827. Unfortunately, stories of slavery at the White House don't often have a happy outcome, and this is definitely one of them.
Thanks, Lina, for that story. In the course of your research, you discovered the payrolls of over 32 enslaved individuals who worked on the White House grounds during the presidency of James Monroe. Can you share with us what you learned about these enslaved individuals and the type of work that they did on the White House grounds?
Sure. So within the National Archives, there are payrolls like this one from construction projects on the White House grounds, which took place from about 1818 to 1834. And this included grading in the President's Square, which is the area in front of the White House. It also included construction for new walls and gates on the grounds and coppering of the roof of the President's House. The payroll revealed these 32 names and also numerous free workers as well. So if you look closely here, you can see a notation for Rich S. Briscoe's Chaz, which is short for Charles. And the fact that this individual is noted as belonging to someone else directly on a payroll makes it clear that Charles was enslaved. On the part of the payroll where you can sign for wages, you can see that an R.S. Briscoe signed and took home $1 a day for the 14 days that his slave Charles worked. And this is the same system of hiring enslaved people that was used during White House construction. Congressional appropriations passed on April 20th, 1818, did set aside a significant amount of money for these construction projects. So some of this federally allocated money was then used to pay the laborers. So for those that were enslaved, the wages went directly to owners like Briscoe. And genealogy research indicates that Briscoe is a man named Richard S. Briscoe, and he resided in Washington, D.C., and census records indicate that he was living with seven enslaved individuals in 1820, which makes it likely that this is the same person that hired out Charles. And what's perhaps most interesting about him is that when he appears again on another payroll a year later in November 1819, he's recorded instead as Charles Shade, but R.S. Briscoe still signed for his wages. So this actually records his last name, which is kind of unique. Sometimes you do see last names of enslaved people, but often it's just listed as whatever their owner's last name may have been. So although no further information has yet been discovered about Charles, the addition of his last name does allow potentially more options in the future for finding more about him. As with all research for this initiative, it's still ongoing.
And as we know, research is often full of surprises. Can you share with us, was there ever a surprising story or element that you learned, perhaps about a president that you didn't realize utilized enslaved labor at the White House?
So there have definitely been a lot of surprises throughout the course of this research, but I think one of the most surprising elements for me and my colleagues, we were surprised to learn about the enslaved individuals that were a part of President John Quincy Adams' White House. Despite being outspoken about the evils of slavery, particularly during his prolific career in the House of Representatives following his presidency, we found evidence linking two enslaved individuals living in his presidential household. So they did not actually belong to Adams, but instead they belonged to his niece and nephew who lived in the White House with the family. So John Quincy Adams' wife, Louisa, pictured here, came from a slave-owning family. And when her sister and brother-in-law died, some of their children went to live with the Adamses off and on. So in particular, this included a young man named Johnson Helen and a young woman named Mary Catherine Helen. It appears that both Johnson and Mary Catherine resided with the Adams at various points in time, because they did bring along enslaved people to John Quincy Adams' White House. The most compelling evidence relates to an enslaved woman named Rachel Clark. So on February 25th, 1828, Mary Catherine Helen married her cousin, John Adams II, at the White House, and that's pictured here in a painting. On the day of that wedding, she filed manumission papers for a woman named Rachel Clark. Rachel had probably already been living with Mary throughout her time in the Adams household, but the Adams census record for 1820, several years prior, does list one female slave under the age of 14. And since it's common for a young white woman in a slave-holding family to be given a servant around that age, there's a strong possibility that this enslaved girl did belong to Mary Catherine. So the question becomes, why did Mary Catherine free Rachel Clark on the day of her marriage? And I guess it could be because she simply wanted to do so out of the kindness of her heart. However, the timing also suggests that her new husband and father-in-law might have asked her to free Rachel. Both Louisa and John Quincy weren't thrilled at their son's choice of wife, and Rachel's presence in their household up to that point makes it clear that John Quincy Adams was willing to tolerate slavery in his household, but probably would not allow his son to bring an enslaved person directly into his family. So ultimately, this story demonstrates that the pervasive nature of slavery in Washington, D.C. itself, and that it made it difficult for Adams to escape the institution, even within his own household and family.
We have one more question, one more story to share this evening, but I want to remind everyone, if you have questions for Lina, please type them in the comments section of the Facebook feed, and we will get to as many of those questions as possible at the conclusion of our program. So the last question has to do with later presidents and slavery. When you think about enslaved individuals in the White House, you typically think of our earlier presidents, our founding era presidents. But slavery in the White House existed for many, many years after that. In fact, the last presidents to utilize enslaved labor at the White House were James Polk and Zachary Taylor. Can you talk a little bit about what slavery was like in the White House in those later years?
Yeah. So during the later years of slavery at the White House and in Washington, D.C., it definitely became a little bit different. So as time wore on within the city itself, the numbers of enslaved people declined as abolitionists repeatedly called for the end of slavery, and also the labor market shifted. Urban slavery required less enslaved individuals, so many people were sold to the Deep South, where they ended up working on cotton plantations. And as the debate over slavery ramped up in Congress in the years preceding the Civil War, presidents were scrutinized closely for their slave ownership. So it appears that some of the later slave-owning presidents, like James K. Polk, used enslaved labor at the White House, but also very carefully considered the optics of what his slave ownership might look like. So in the midst of the Mexican-American War, letters from James K. Polk to a slave purchasing agent named Robert Campbell reveal that the president was engaged in the secret purchase of enslaved children to labor on his Mississippi plantation. The letters implore Campbell to proceed with caution and secrecy, stating, "The reasons why it should not be known to anyone but him and yourself that you are making these purchases for me. There is nothing wrong in it, but still the public have no interest in knowing it. In my situation, it is better they should not." So this letter clearly demonstrates that Polk is kind of doing an uncomfortable balancing act. Although he personally supported slavery and received political support from Southerners and Westerners as president, he also had to consider the growing anti-slavery sentiment and the recent successes of the abolitionist movement. So with the expansion of slavery on the line, Polk chose secrecy to prevent additional public scrutiny. But the reality is that Polk owned a profitable cotton plantation in Mississippi and was a big-time slave owner. So the purchase of the 12 enslaved children listed here was to help Polk prepare for his own retirement. Most of the individuals purchased while Polk was president were sent to work on his Mississippi plantation and help him turn a profit. In addition to purchasing enslaved children, Polk also brought enslaved laborers to the White House, including a man named Elias Polk. So prior to his time in the White House, Elias had been gifted to James as a wedding present by his father back in 1824 and had served the Polk family for many years. And although he likely worked at the White House when James K. Polk was elected and went to the office in 1845, he was then hired out to another man named James H. Thomas through 1846. It is then that Elias ended up rejoining the presidential household in 1847 before returning with the Polks after the presidency to their Tennessee home and plantation. Polk died just 3 months after leaving the presidency, and Elias ended up remaining there with his wife. And although his time at the White House is pretty typical for an enslaved person, it's his later life that is quite interesting to me. So during the Civil War, Elias Polk remained in Nashville with Sarah Polk, and when Union forces showed up, he defiantly told them, "I'm for the rights of the South and the territories," which is definitely not what you'd expect to hear from an enslaved person. But after gaining his freedom following the Civil War, Elias actually ended up establishing himself as a political leader in Tennessee and continued to defend the South. And surprisingly for a man freed from slavery, he politically aligned himself with white Southern elites and the Democratic Party, and eventually did return to Washington, where he worked in the US Capitol as a laborer. And then at the very end of his life, he took a trip to Washington, where he got to shake hands with Grover Cleveland at the White House, which he was very excited about because Grover Cleveland was the first Democratic president elected since James Buchanan. And as a staunch Democrat, he wanted to show his support. And he ended up dying on the same trip to Washington after falling ill on December 30th, 1846.
Well, I think we have some questions from our online audience. They look like very good questions. The first one is from Alicia, and she asks, have you located any descendants of the slaves discussed?
So that is an ongoing project. The first phase of this initiative was to build out this website. And now our second step is to make more community connections and reach out to descendants. So we have been in a contact with a few descendants related to the Decatur House enslaved community. And we are looking to make further contact moving forward. But we do have an email address set up that you can send in your questions, or if you have any additional information about any of the enslaved people discussed today, or if you know something that you might want us to know or look into further, we are definitely happy to take those questions and try and answer them for you guys.
Lindsay asks, what was your favorite primary source material that you discovered?
I think one of my favorite primary source materials was definitely looking into all of the genealogy information related to mapping where slave owners and the enslaved people building the White House came from. That required me to go very deep onto various genealogical databases and really dig through a ton of documents. And there's a ton more research there to do as well. So hopefully in the future, I'll get to travel to places in Southern Maryland and further look into archives to flesh that out.
Okay, Demetria asks a good question. I think maybe possibly spurred by your discussion of Fannie Hearn. When an enslaved woman working in the White House had a child, who would care for her child when she was attending to her duties?
That's a really good question. Unfortunately, it's not a very easy question to answer because of the lack of documentary evidence. While we can, you know, build a broader picture of the lives of some of these people and you know, give some detail, those day-to-day things like who's taking care of the children are a little bit more difficult to answer. It's possible that they would have remained in the care of the mother and that the mother would have just taken them along into the kitchen, but it's also likely that the child would have been placed with another enslaved person or another servant working in the home.
Precious asks, what is the origin of last names of enslaved Blacks, if they were indeed at all recorded?
That is also a really good question. It seems that a lot of the enslaved people working at the president's house, like for example, Elias Polk, did take the last name of his owner, but a lot of other people did have family names, and those would have been passed down from their ancestors. I think one of the big challenges that faced enslaved people is the fact that they were often separated from their family members at a moment's notice. And in particular, enslaved children were taken from their parents and sold. So depending on what age that happened, they may have no record of a family name. They may just have to go off of whatever name their owner had.
Bernice asks, can you talk a little bit about slaves that were sold into the Deep South? How were they transported to the Deep South? She's very interested in slave ship manifest documents and how you might be able to obtain those documents.
So most enslaved people that were transferred to from the Mid-Atlantic region to the South, that happened on boats. So a lot of the slave trading centers were along the coast, like, for example, as I mentioned, Alexandria, and also Washington, D.C. itself had slave trading happening. So they would have gone by boat down to places, big hotspots like Louisiana, and then they would have gone to various plantations from there.
Terrific. And please, all of our viewers, keep these questions coming. They're excellent. Tell us, what were some of the challenges or difficulties when you were engaging in this type of historical research?
Ooh, that is a good one. There are certainly a lot of challenges. I think the most obvious challenge is the fact that a lot of times you're working from nothing. You may have, somebody may have mentioned a name, and that may be all that you have. So you really have to start tracing kind of unexpected sources. Like for example, when I was looking into the enslaved people on the White House grounds, I found that doing completely different research just about the White House grounds in general. And another author had mentioned in a tiny footnote that there might be these records in the National Archives. So it's a lot of really small, minute details that can end up creating a wealth of sources.
Stephanie asks, besides the National Museum of African American History and Culture, where else would you recommend I bring college students to learn about this history? We've considered Monticello, but we would like to hear several different types of narratives.
Sure. I think that one of the really cool projects that you may have heard of would be the 1619 Project. They by the New York Times. They have had some incredible resources. Also, our site has some incredible resources as well. So definitely check that out. Presidential sites, of course, can reveal a lot of information, but I think what is particularly notable about this research is that we are looking specifically at the 8-year period or 4-year period when presidents would have lived in the White House. And that was a very, you know, transient time. So we're definitely looking at different aspects of White House slavery than you might be looking at for perhaps Monticello, where you're looking at, you know, the day-to-day operation of all of Jefferson's land holdings, as opposed to how he operated his presidential household. So definitely you could go to places like Monticello. Also, Montpelier has incredible resources, and they've recently done an awesome exhibit on the enslaved people at Montpelier, which is James Madison's residence.
Julie asks a popular story that we often hear a lot at the White House Historical Association, the saving of George Washington's portrait when the White House was burned. She asks, Dolly Madison gets the credit for saving that portrait, but wasn't it a slave that helped her save the painting?
Yeah, so this is definitely one of those misconceptions that we get a lot. It is the very popular story. However, an enslaved man named Paul Jennings, who's actually the first person to write a White House memoir describing his time there. So he was enslaved in James Madison's White House, and he writes that Dolly Madison, while she did direct, she directed that the painting be removed and saved, it was actually enslaved workers and other servants that removed the painting and brought it out of the White House.
George asks, what happened to enslaved individuals who worked at the White House or were working on the White House who died while in service? Is there a burial ground in Washington, D.C. for enslaved individuals?
So in terms of individuals that built the White House, there doesn't appear to be any sort of grave that we know of. However, it's possible that it's still out there and waiting to be discovered. So that's definitely would go in the category of things that we would love to find out and are still pursuing.
A few people have asked online whether any of the research done by the association will be published in book form.
Well, I would say hopefully in the future. Launching all of these web articles and our a timeline was kind of our phase one. So as we move forward in the project, that's definitely something I would love to see happen.
Can you talk, were there any relationships between the enslaved individuals who lived at Decatur House, where we both work whenever we're actually working in Washington, D.C. and not teleworking? Were there any relationships between the slaves at Decatur House and the enslaved individuals working at the White House?
Yeah, so there definitely seems to be some connection. So Decatur House itself, of course, was originally built in 1818 by Stephen Decatur, a naval commodore. However, he soon died, and so the house was rented out to a bunch of prominent individuals. So Henry Clay lived there as Secretary of State, and then also Martin Van Buren lived there as Secretary of State. And there does appear to be some relation between the individuals in Martin Van Buren's household at Decatur House and his household at the White House. So yes, there is a very interesting connection, and it appears that enslaved individuals living with Martin Van Buren ended up following him over to the White House just across the street.
Alexa asks, any books that you recommend that we read about slavery at the White House?
Yeah, if you want to look into a book about building the White House, a historian named Bob Arnbeck, he was really instrumental in my research, and he has a book called Slave Labor in the Capitol, which is really useful. And then there's tons of other books that delve into various presidents. For example, James Conroy has a book called, The White House on the Potomac. Monticello on the Potomac. And it's about Jefferson's White House, and it describes his enslaved people.
Jamon asks, what is a surprising job that enslaved people did at the White House?
I think that one of the jobs that's more interesting to me would be the people that worked in the stables, because I often think about how their job would have brought them out more frequently to the broader Washington community as they, you know, transported presidents and their families around the city, and also the people that went out to buy supplies. I always think about, and we don't have the documentary evidence for necessarily, but I always try and imagine what were their interactions with the rest of the city like, and how deep were the relationships that existed between the free Black community and Washington's enslaved community. I'd love to learn more about that.
Carolyn asks, what would you say is the most significant discovery that you've made in the course of your own research in this area?
For me personally, I think that the genealogy research that I've done on the people building the White House is the most significant to me. I don't think it's been done before to quite the extent that I'm trying to take it out to. And so for me, that's something that I'm still working on and hope to provide more information on.
Bernice asks, do you have any knowledge of the religious practices of the enslaved people at the White House?
Unfortunately, that is one of those elements that I just don't have a ton of information on. It is certainly likely that they would have taken part in whatever religion their owner would have done. That's pretty common. So they likely would have held some sort of church service similar to whoever they belonged to. But that information remains unclear.
Nicole asks, any recommended sources on slavery in Washington, D.C.? So not just at the White House, but also about the history of slavery in the city.
I think one of the best books out right now on this topic would be Chocolate City. It's a really excellent overview of not just slavery, but the entire African-American experience within Washington, D.C., and it has a ton of really good information.
Okay, so the last question we have this evening, I'd like to ask you, Lina, tell us, we started this discussion with Michelle Obama in 2016, who remarked, you know, famously that she wakes up every morning in a house built by slaves. So we know why this is important to Mrs. Obama. Tell us what you have found most rewarding about your research. We've talked about significance, historical significance. We've talked about things that have been surprising. But why do you engage in this research and why do you find it rewarding?
So I engage in this research because I think that it's really important to tell undertold stories and bring information to light that people should know about. And the slavery at the White House is certainly one of those things. Often the White House, as I mentioned, is seen as this big symbol of democracy. Of course, it retains some sort of, Americans know it and they think about it, but they may not always think about the uglier elements that also existed with the White House. So it's really rewarding to me whenever we do get emails from, you know, outside people that have been touched by our research or have questions about our research, knowing that this information is being seen by people and the story is now being told on a wider level is very important to me.
Well, thank you very much, Lina, for joining us this evening. And thank you to all of our viewers that joined us this evening. We hope to bring you more programs like this on White House History Live on Facebook in the future. In the meantime, please take a look at whitehousehistory.org for great stories about White House history, including our Researching Slavery in the President's Neighborhood initiative, which you can find on our website. Have a terrific evening, and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you.
Thank you.